Who you are?
Okay, I'm Dr. Larry Myers, and I am an empath or sensitive. For the past 25 years, I've been studying metaphysics and mediumship. I have been going to Lilydale Assembly for approximately 14 years. That's near Buffalo. This is the spiritualist community where the Fox sisters began spiritualism, and their house at Hydesdale. This is the center where Sir Arthur Conan Doyle visited, where Susan B. Anthony began the women's movement. Incidentally, the house that she stayed in is on sale right now as we speak. This is the place where Deepak Chopra has gone to, where Shirley MacLaine is very much in contact with, and this is where Mae West cut the ribbon on the church, and her picture is still in front of the church. This spiritualist community had a summer home in Casadega, Florida, which I have also visited twice. Last time I was at Casadega was last year on March 14th, which is the birthday of Jack Kerouac and Edward Albee. On that day, March 14th, I conducted a seance and I contacted both their spirits. I took my friend
Ed. I have a tape phone conversation of Jack Kerouac talking to Allen Ginsberg, mm-hmm. which I have on tape in there.
Well, my first contact with Jack Kerouac came because I wrote a play about Jack Kerouac, and it was done in Lowell, Massachusetts.
So happened? What happened when is there a reason or you're, and I don't want, I don't, what I'm trying to get is, have you had any contact with Marsha B. Johnson or
yes,
Sylvia Rivera?
Yes, that's why I'm sitting here.
Well, that's what I want to know about.
Okay, well, my connection with Marsha Johnson is that I was contacted to be interviewed for this film. And
that's David Francis, The Death and Life of Marsha B. Johnson.
I believe so, yes. And there are people that I know that are in the film. But the reason that I didn't...
You're a college professor too, right?
For 40 years.
Where?
At St. John's University. I taught at Cincinnati Conservatory of Music before that and Kent State University.
And what was you taught music? That was
acting.
Acting. Oh, you're a theater.
Yes, and the actors that I've discovered are James Gandolfini, Christopher Maloney, Maria Bello, Angelica Page, who's Jolene.
Okay, so let's get back to Marsha Johnson.
Okay,
you're
back to Marsha Johnson. I lived in the village as long ago as the 1960s, okay? I knew Marsha Johnson in the 70s. I lived in the village on 13th Street, and I remember when Marsha was at the lamp shop on Christopher.
That was my lamp shop.
And I remember encounters with her there. I remember one day she had...
Do you remember me from that lamp shop?
Yes. Yes, and you were very kind to me. There were so many lamps I couldn't see your face. But I remember Marsha had an entire chandelier on her head one day, and she was walking down the street. I think I wrote a poem about this and the fact that her inner light was brighter than the chandelier. And my whole...
That's a fabulous description.
My whole idea and connection to her is that there are certain authentic individuals who are connected to a higher frequency and higher vibration. Now, they may not be cause to effect linear narrative PhD scholars. However, they're connected to the light. And everything is about electricity and light and energy and vibration and frequency. And
you know, I want to say something just to make it clear.
Sure.
I'm a journalist.
Right.
I think that this clairvoyant, I have the popular opinion
right.
that a lot of what you're saying is utter nonsense. However,
okay.
when you talk about the connection with light,
right.
and why do you put those on? It makes you look like you just spoke some heroin or something.
Well, no, I put these on because...
To be anonymous?
I put these on because you're sitting in front of a picture of Marsha Johnson, and I'm getting her face. But also, I'm putting these on because my eyes got damaged. I was volunteering in Napa Valley with this fire people. I was right at the fire zone. And I was in the hospital with smoke inhalation.
How long ago?
Well, that was a couple of weeks ago. I'm
still coughing.
But I hurt my eyes.
Oh.
And so when I wake up in the morning,
Okay, I want to get back to just on the energy and light thing.
Sure, sure.
Well, I'm an atheist. I believe I cease to exist. But one time, mm-hmm. I went to a phosphorescent bay in Puerto Rico.
Right.
And when the moon is dark and you swim in the waters light up with your hand. Every
right.
movement,
right.
ripples go off the bow of the boat.
Right.
Fish in the water, if they dash, you see a streak of light in the water. And I said to my fellow atheist, I said, you know, I said, it was like I had suddenly plugged into this light stream of energy that courses through the universe. And I said, I had no problem with thinking that when I die, the electrical impulses that are my brain or my body go back into this live stream of energy that pulses through the universe. Now, that to me is getting awfully close to religious belief. And what was amazing, you know, my fellow atheists, yeah, I consider myself very spiritual, but I may call myself also an atheist evangelist because I don't like any organized religions, although I like Buddha.
Well, Madame Blavatsky said that organized religion was the death of spirituality. Now, what I...
Okay, so get back to about Marsha B. Johnson. Tell me some good stories that people can start incorporating.
Marsha Johnson was a figure that was placed in a certain time in the web. Let me explain to you my position in the web.
No, but let me... I want to focus on Marsha B. Have you... As she's... I don't know what this thing talking or seeing or communicating with. I mean, I don't know where do you go with that? I mean, did you ever tell me real life stories of events with Marsha, and me anything that has happened since she died that made you think?
All right, I'll tell you exactly what it is.
Okay.
I used to talk to her on the street all the time. Now, this goes back many, many years. And all of the conversations were very fast and quick. They were sort of like young people texting or Instagram. She moved very quickly. She was very kinetic. And to me, she was connected to the life force. She didn't have time for a paragraph. She was like a human Instagram or a human tweet, you know. She was life itself. And I was very... I don't know. One time she gave me a bracelet. And I have that bracelet, but I have to find it.
Oh, please, find it.
Oh, no. I
put it in the museum.
Well, it was in a plastic bag.
You know, I found a veil that she used. I have almost no droppings of Marsha in the apartment.
Well,
I found a veil, which I think, I found one piece of paper where she wrote the lyrics of the song, Lavender Balloon, on a piece of paper.
Right.
Unbelievable. She lived with me, and I have so few physical
things. Well,
that's
because she was of the spirit world. That's because she wasn't tied to this plane.
She would give away everything she owned.
Absolutely. And this is the way I am. I'm a crazy person. I turned in a savings account and got all the money, and I've created the Playwright Sanctuary for found gay history staged in found theater spaces. I cashed in thousands of dollars. I have an office now in San Francisco. I have an office in New York City. I have expanded my work to Washington, D.C., Fort Lauderdale, Houston, Dallas, and now Phoenix. I am going to mentor young playwrights writing about gay history. They don't even remember 10 minutes ago, let alone 10 years ago.
Gay history begins with each gay person the day that they came out and started being active in the gay life.
Okay.
They don't know about anything that happened in Germany in 1890.
No.
They don't know there wasn't a word for us in 1865.
No. Well, I'm going to...
Or that they were doing great in Germany and Hitler burned all our files in 1931 or 32?
I'm going to Chicago to the home of the man that started the magazine. You know, when he came from Germany, he had like a pen pal magazine, and he was a gay activist.
Who's that?
And this
Gerber?
Gerber.
Right.
And Gerber's
1932, right?
Yes, and Gerber's buried in Washington. And
I know, you know, I wonder, because he was alive in 1962.
Right.
In some sort of old age home or facility.
Right.
And at that time, Frank Kameny was becoming active.
Yes.
And I don't know anything about Gerber's life, I don't know of any interaction between them.
No.
Him and the Mattachine Society.
No interaction whatsoever.
Why?
Gerber got fed up because, well, first of all,
he got fed up because all they wanted to do was get together and have parties and sex.
He had syphilis 12 times. he was buried in Washington, and I went.
Where?
He's in the cemetery.
Which one?
I have it written down.
Congressional Cemetery.
No, I have it written down.
Arlington National Cemetery?
He might be, yes. I'm not sure, but don't quote me on that.
Okay.
But let me tell you.
This is video, not...
Okay, I'm in touch with the gentleman that wrote the book, Chicago Whispers. And he has given me some information. I'm messaging him. You see, there's interest in my theater foundation.
Right.
Edward Albee endorsed it.
Okay.
Initially, I was going to start.
So what are you thinking of doing about Marsha or Sylvia? Because there are several plays floating around, people trying to write plays.
Well, that's why I'm writing my own. I'm writing my own. And I started writing this a long time ago.
Well, what do you think the important thing to tell about Marsha is? Why don't you tell me like life experiences, things that happened besides the bracelet she gave you? What else? What else interactions do you remember?
I've had communication with her, basically.
When?
Near the Stonewall Park now, in front of the Stonewall, and in that area. I know when you talk about this, I have a PhD. I had tenure for 40 years.
You know, I'm in contact with pagans. There was a pagan altar in Tompkins Square Park.
Absolutely.
I think it'd be very interesting to have you and people who believe in this to sort of have a spiritual reunion.
Absolutely.
With Marsha P. Johnson.
Absolutely.
In the Stonewall National Park.
Absolutely. I can tell you.
I'm getting myself into Looney Tunesville, you know.
No, you're getting yourself into enlightenment, and you've gone behind the veil, is what happened to you. What you did is you woke up, and other
people... Well, I want to make her the first transgender saint in the Roman Catholic Church, and I am a confirmed member of the Roman Catholic Church. Once you're confirmed, you can never get out until you get a bull of excommunication, which I used to want, but now the new pope I like, so I don't want it anymore.
I was confirmed. I was baptized as a Catholic.
And confirmed?
And my real name is Czechoslovakian, but I don't go by that. I go by Myers. My mother divorced my Czechoslovakian father.
So tell me about your communication with Marsha. What does she say to you? What is it?
My Catholic business first.
Okay.
My boss at St. John's University, my dean, was Father David O'Connell. He went on to become the president of Catholic University. He was the priest on television with St. Francis, or Pope Francis, and the German Pope. I had a communication with St. Francis of Assisi at the North Beach Church, where they have a reconstruction of St. Francis of Assisi's chapel, and they had a relic of him. Now, you are saying that you are an atheist. Let me explain to you, en route to Marsha Johnson, what happened to me. I was at Yale, at New Haven, at a play at Yale. And it was a good play. And I had a friend contact me and say, Larry, you need to go to the Knights of Columbus Museum because they're having a celebration. Mother Teresa is becoming Saint Teresa today, and you need to go. And I said, oh God. I said, John Waters should make a movie of Mother Teresa starring Linda Hunt. I just made fun of her all day, and I go, ha, ha, ha. And I went to look for the museum, and I couldn't find it. I went back to the hotel, got my suitcase, and I go, I'm getting out of here. I got into a cab. He went the wrong turn. We go down a street. There's a big picture of Mother Teresa in the museum, and I'm right at the museum. I go into the museum. They go, why are you here? I said, I'm Dr. Myers from St. John's University in New York. They go, come with us. There's a relative of Mother Teresa, or a relic of Mother Teresa here. And there's the painting that's going to the Vatican. I knelt down in front of the relic, and all of a sudden, this energy, like, knocked me. It was like being hit by a roller coaster. And I saw a vision of Christ. Now, if you tell people this, they think you're out of your bloody mind. Well, I started crying uncontrollably. There were nuns there. And they said, do you have a connection to her? And I said, well, I guess I do. I mean, this was news to me. So I investigated Mother Teresa. Why the hell am I? You know, she was against...
Okay, but let's get back to Marsha.
Yeah,
I'm about to Marsha. How does this get to Marsha?
The one thing about Mother Teresa that I'm keyed into is there's a spiritual, supernatural world dimension that's very real. Her idea about not abortion, I'm against abortion, but other, her ideas about the Catholic Church and all, believe me, I am very into the intercession of the saints. I am not into banning gay, blah, 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 blah. Let's get back to Marsha. Marsha is one of these people. I met with homeless people in Miami Beach. I was in cahoots with this priest, and we met homeless people. This homeless woman moved into a shelter. She cooked me dinner one time. I work with those people there. In the summer, I work with people in San Francisco okay. that lived in tents.
And how
these people all know who Marsha Johnson is. I was in Washington, D.C. at the Equality March. Up to 100 degrees, I passed out and had to go to a cooling tent. There were people there with What Would Marsha Johnson Say t-shirts, one of whom interviewed me, I don't know what it was for, and he said, you know, what's your interest in Marsha Johnson? I said, well, I started writing a play about her. I said, Maria Bello, who was an actress in one of my plays, Small Town Gals with Big Problems, who was a Golden Globe nominee, said she wanted to make a movie about Marsha Johnson. Maria Bello came out as a lesbian. She's not lesbian anymore, blah, blah. I don't know what happened to that. Anyway, Marsha Johnson, to me, is somehow connected to primitivism, Wicca, spirituality.
She would be prostrate in front of the statue of the Virgin Mary in the church across the street at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
I never
yes.
knew how religious she was.
Yes,
she was extremely religious.
Very much
and
so.
And she, in a way, she hit it, because at one point I made something about being an atheist on one of the videos I have up with her.
Right.
She just looks at me strangely. She never took issue with me. But
yeah.
I remember once I was real depressed, and really depressed on Thanksgiving Day, and she came over and she started singing this song. Jesus loves me, yeah. how do I know? Because the Bible tells
me so.
And I laughed my head off. I said, where did you learn
Jesus
that? She said, in church.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so.
So anyway, she sang that to me. I said, where'd
right.
you find that? But she had the ability to
right.
to just bring these strange
right.
things, and it may even, totally change my day. I mean, Marsha had this ability to sense how you were.
Right.
And to suddenly just pull something out that, and I never was real, I really never appreciated that about Marsha. She never, you know, even I have a friend who's very prejudiced against groups of people.
Right.
And I would say, you know, he would call blacks N's and Spanish people S's and all that. And I'd say
right.
to Marsha, I said, it drives me crazy, because he was one of my employees.
Right.
And I was trying to get Marsha to side with me, because I was furious at this person.
Right.
Who I
but
still
she
know.
Didn't,
no,
did she?
You know what she said? She said, well, Randy, you know, there are a lot of people that way. And this was incredible. I just told her how
right.
this person had displayed such disgusting bigotry to me, and I thought I could get her at least. I was so furious at him for being a bigot, and I turned to Marsha for support, thinking, well, she at least would say, you know, something, well, really, you have a right to be mad or
right.
angry. And instead, she was just all forgiving. She just was not even just, and yet, you know, that same person
yeah.
loved Marsha. Marsha was always invited to his house, to his Thanksgiving dinners, to
right.
his, he wasn't individually prejudiced.
Right.
If a friend, I had a Spanish friend was with him in a park, some black kids ran into the park from the other side. He thought they were coming
right.
to him. They were running out to play a pickup game of basketball.
Right.
And he was terrified. My Spanish friend thought it was funny that his own bigotry had framed his mind such.
Well, life is very...
But yet Marsha
yeah.
was able to be... Marsha, I asked Willie, how do you know when Marsha had... You know, if the person, one person was the head of the World Trade Center. He was a greeter at the top of... Windows of the World, top
right.
of the World Trade Center.
Right.
I said, you don't know whether he's going to be an incredibly famous person or he's going to be some crazy person. And he said, have you ever seen people walking along the street talking to themselves? I said, sure. He said, most people walk to the other side of the street. He said, Marsha would just stand there and they'd come up and start talking to her. And she would stand there and just listen to them.
Well, I'll tell you, I had...
So she was everyone's friend.
Well, I had a lot of communication with Marsha Johnson where we would just look at one another and smile, and we didn't really, like...
Now, you're talking about since she died or when she was alive?
Both. When she was alive, I told you, she spoke almost like, you know, Morse code or something. That
okay,
you
well, tell me about, any, if you had any experiences seeing her or talking to her.
Yes, she told me that I have to play her. And I'm like, I can't put on blackface. You know, there are laws that a white actor...
Are there laws now on that?
You can't put blackface on. You'll be arrested and closed down, or they'll picket you. But the thing is, I'm a little too old to play her now. But I thought, well, I'll play her as a white person, but I'll have a mask of a black, and I'll have the mask that I can, you know, hold the mask up and be a little Marsha, then take it down and I'll be Marsha. And so I came up with the idea of calling the play the Marsha P. Johnson Mirror. And that is that when you look in
okay,
the mirror,
well, we have only a minute or two left to finish this whole thing.
You go to the other side of the mirror so somebody can plug into being Marsha, or you find the Marsha Johnson mirror inside of you.
So that's a beautiful idea. And when is this going to be done? Or
well, I started working on it, but you know, there's the money of who's going to produce it and where,
right.
And then I have to show up every night and do it. So maybe I'll do it as a reading and be like Spalding Gray. I work with Spalding Gray.
Okay,
so
you wanted to give some contact information and address or some
internet? Yes. LaurenceLarry1@AOL.com. LaurenceLarry1@AOL.com.
And how about any website or
no, I don't have one.
You don't, okay.
I don't even have a cell phone.
Oh.
Email me.
I will. Thank you. Bye-bye.